Well, I used to go to Mass every morning, you see. I used to get up at 6 o'clock every morning and go to Mass. And in those days, you were not allowed to eat or drink anything before you took communion, so... But I didn't like food. I was a very strange child in many ways, because I didn't like food. I wouldn't eat meat. I wouldn't eat chicken. I would eat a bit of fish occasionally. But my favourite food was going into the garden and plucking a beetroot out of the ground and rubbing it up against the wall to get the skin off and eating it right from the ground. And the same with carrots. And those were my favourite things.
You were asked...
By the way, there wasn't that much food around. You got 1 egg a week and 2 ounces of meat. That's 2 ounces of meat is about that big. But I gave mine away, all kinds of my brothers.
What do you want to be when you grow up? And instead of saying train driver or policeman or whatever it was, a working class boy in Liverpool at that time was supposed to want, you said?
I said I wanted to be a movie star.
And live a lovely life.
And the egg didn't exist in those days. It was an extraordinary thing for a child from a very working class background to say they wanted to be a movie star. And I paid for it because they thumped me even more after that. Because they were like trying to be uppity. And I was very good at art. And I think somewhere it had crossed me. In my mind, I wanted to be a movie star.
In a sense, your dream sort of came true then, didn't it? I mean, you didn't quite become a movie star.
They wouldn't let me. I was in quite a few movies, actually. And then I got the part of a Chinese girl in The Road to Hong Kong, in Crosby and Bobhead. But unfortunately, just a few weeks before shooting started, people in the newspaper exposed me, and they tried to sack me. But the 6 Eurasian girls I was working with were absolutely marvelous. We'd become such good friends, and these 6 beautiful girls, Bing Crosby was having a wild affair with one of them, really. They said, well, they could go, we go. And of course, they didn't. They couldn't possibly restart everything, the casting, because it would cost thousands and thousands of pounds. But there was a very amusing moment when they were doing the Chinese makeup. I looked ridiculous with this Oriental makeup because I looked like the English rose. And when they were putting all these pieces of hair on my hair, I suddenly pointed at this big piece of and I said, well, could I possibly have that one on my head? And they said, oh no, that's Miss Collins's fringe. Collins. Think about that. So, that was terrible. But they took my part away from me. They kept my back to the camera, and they took my name off the credits. People used to laugh at me, but I said, you know, slow motion. Wonderful. Very nice man, by the way.
But didn't you also try and make your voice deeper?
Yes, unfortunately, I used to sing solo in front of the whole school, and we had a wonderful choir. But I got so fed up with everyone saying, you know, you're a girl, this, that, and the other, that I had some kind of breakdown, and I broke my voice. During my divorce, I had to be examined from head to toe. I had everything x-rayed. They listened to my voice, and the specialist, and they said, well, her voice is cracked, and so something must have happened. But that's why I can't even hold a note. If I started singing, you'd go out of this room. I sound like an innocent bear. Very sad. I should have kept it, but I didn't know what the future held. Very worried. But nobody could see you. And unfortunately, Tim, we'd just been in Morocco together in Tangiers, and he was meant to pick me up. I was living in Spain at the time. Unfortunately, he was drowned. He didn't pick me up, thank goodness. He said they found no wreckage of the yacht or anything. And he had this group called the Beatles, and I said, yeah, I never heard of them. What do they do? He said, well, they sing. And I said, yeah, I love it. He said, well, they're quite famous now. They just had the most enormous success in Germany. And they want to use your table. Would you mind terribly if they had it one evening and you had it the next? I said, oh, goodness, no. I said, that's perfectly democratic. I said, that's fine. But on the evenings when it was my turn, John Lennon, Paul McCartney, they said, oh, welcome to the fucking Duchess, now we have to move. And he said, yes, you do. And Jerry and the pacemakers, because they're one day, and he just brought out Ferry across the Mersey. And he's a tiny little man. And he said, oh, the fucking hell has happened? I said, no. I said, get back on that ferry, go right back across that Mersey, and stay there. Move. So, and when I closed the year of culture for Liverpool in 2008, we talked about the Beatles, and I said, what a boring your star was. And then I said, oh my God, everyone's going to hate me, they're the Beatles. You know, they applauded like mad. Because apparently he'd just been in Liverpool, and he was very rude about Liverpool. And Liverpool is one of the most beautiful cities in the world. It has the first skyscraper in the world, the Liver Buildings, because that was opened in 1911. The Empire State Building and the Chrysler Buildings, they weren't opened until the 1930s. So nobody realizes that Liverpool had the first skyscraper. It was quite fascinating. They'll get rid of your entourage, because they're, by this time, terribly famous. You know, we've got about 20 people there. So I said, get rid of all the tarts that are with you first. And so all these poor girls were sent off. And then I said, get rid of your entourage. And then we were together, and drinking champagne. He said, would you go to bed with me? And I said, okay. And I said, you get the bill and I'll get the taxi. Well, now, I had a restaurant at this time. Every taxi driver in London knew me very well. I said to the taxi driver, I said, when I say go, go, the Paul McCartney comes out, you know, all joyful. And I said to the taxi driver, go. And all I heard was, you fucking bitch, I hate you. But we was okay afterwards. I mean, we were friends afterwards. And George Harrison was so lovely. And I did a show with John Lennon and Yoko Ono with poor Simon Dee. I don't know if you remember Simon Dee. And he committed professional suicide by objecting children, about children doing commercials on television. But of course you can't play about with the people with the money and the power, because you can't win. And that poor man ended up driving a bus around London. But it was nice to see John and Yoko. She asked to film my bottom. That's how I met her. She rang out and, I hear you very beautiful. I want to film your bottom. Me Yoko Ono. I said, me a flashly, me no light. But I'm told it's a cult movie. And her philosophy was that bottoms had more character than faces. And I said, how can that be? A bottom doesn't have eyes. That's it.